So growing success defines triangulation as occurring when teachers use a variety of assessment strategies to elicit information about student learning. This is an idea that we've been talking about for a number of years with growing success as well as with AER. It's not a concept that is new to us, right? It plays an essential role in assessing student learning over an extended period of time and guides the professional judgment of classroom teachers. And that's really the power of triangulation. The idea that we don't have to rely upon a computer program to spit out a mark for us. We gather data through, you want to flip to the next one? Through our observations of student learning, through our conversation with students about their learning, and then through those end products that they ultimately produce. Triangulation is great for kids. It's great for kids for a number of different reasons. It levels the playing field. My little guy, I have an 8-year-old, so you guys are high school teachers, so but I feel like it's relatable. He is not a strong writer, but he is a great talker. He's an epic talker. And so triangulation is great for my son because it gives him an opportunity to have conversations and to have teachers observe what he's doing in the classroom and use that information to determine his knowledge and understanding of whatever it is that he's learning. Triangulation also encourages variation in the types of assessment activities. So it goes to that differentiated instruction piece that we keep talking about, that we give students multiple opportunities to show us what they know using a variety of different means. The last thing is it allows us as teachers to look at the process of learning. It's a process, not an event or a final product. This ultimately helps us in determining students' strengths and weaknesses. We can see what our individual students are really great at, but we can also see what they need more time and emphasis with. And this guides future learning goals for that individual student, but can also shape the course of our program for the rest of a semester. As I said, this is not a new idea. You folks are doing this every day, and that shows that we in Waterloo Region are at the forefront of what education is supposed to be in this province. However, there are challenges that come with triangulation that need to be addressed.
Okay, so just to go over it again quickly, we've got observations, conversations, and products. Emily talked about why it was great for students, but I just wanted to mention why I think it's great for teachers too. Could be just my opinion, but I feel like triangulation sometimes is very confusing for teachers, and because of that, we don't have confidence with it. I see it more as this is where we get our professional judgment from, right? We can take pieces from conversations, pieces from observations, pieces from products to come up with a better understanding of what the student knows. And I think we should find strength in that as opposed to always being confused about it.
Some of the confusion, though, comes from finding the best way to record and track that information. So this is my dining room table about a week ago when I was doing progress reports to send home for my students. So I've got notes that I keep online. I've also got paper notes in my little notebook there when I'm walking around the classroom. I use Class Dojo to keep track of learning skills. I've got my traditional markbook tracking sheet there. There's information literally everywhere. And when you're dealing with that volume of information, it can become discouraging and it can result in some challenges when we try and produce the final student profile.
So as we're collecting all this, I'm sure we all ask ourselves, how do I or we record and present the data that we collect? We've got this mess of things and we try and put it all together. Does anybody have the magic bullet so far? Or is that why you're here, right? Because you're trying to figure that out, okay? So this leads us to draw the conclusion that the tools that have been offered to us are not effective in tracking student progress using triangulation. As teachers, I find that we accept a lot of things. We accept the loss of time, a loss in production, and the loss of patience. We're here today to try and, you know, advocate for you guys to help be advocates for all teachers to push for change when we see it, okay? We've used Markbook for a while, right? And we've made it work, right? We use all kinds of tools, and teachers just make things work. I feel like it's part of the job description. But it doesn't need to be, okay? if we build a stronger voice to say exactly what we want, and we start using those channels to communicate to people that make these decisions, we found in our experience with this that they're listening and they want to help, okay? But we just need to direct that communication in the right direction. So I'm going to talk about my experience, and then Emily Dixon's going to jump in and talk about the admin perspective here. So I'm not just going to start with this because the guys in this presentation right now, but collaborating with colleagues about assessment, Scott Kemp came up with an idea, I can't remember how many years ago now, but we were talking at different symposiums and things like that and talking about the need for change in assessment. He came up with this idea of maybe we flip and have essential learnings and have all your assessments at the top and we focus on what's most recent, most consistent, and we use maybe a color coding system or something like that. So Dan Ballantyne was part of that, and then they sort of showed me that, and I just tried to take it and run with it as best I could. That comes in with the identifying the gap or the need part. So I created this tool or spreadsheet in Excel or Google Sheets, but I got to a point where it still wasn't working. It was focused a lot on the summative side, but I still had all this formative stuff over here, all these conversations and observations still scattered all over the place. So I was going in the right direction, at least I felt like I was, but it wasn't good enough. So then I got to the point where I would tell anybody that would listen to me that we needed an assessment tool that matches our practices. That meant talking to consultants. Consultants would then talk to other people in the board. I talked with people like Harry Neeson, Kim Wittek, Michael Sendria, and Stuart Cross at one point. But lucky for me, and they all did a great job of listening and passing it on, but there was no direct path to get an answer. I had Emily Dixon as a VP, and she can jump in and talk about that side of it, but she was the one that really got the ball moving for us.
Okay, I just wanted to talk about the admin perspective, because the teacher voice was coming out loud and clear to administrators that with AER and the concept of professional judgment, we want to know that administrators are going to support us. And so I felt really strongly that we needed to advocate for a tool that would allow for teachers to collect the data that they felt could support their professional judgment. So I had the opportunity of being admin at two different schools and work with wonderful teachers that were trying different apps. I created a ridiculous Excel spreadsheet myself. This was not the one that Ben created. It was literally this big when you printed it out and very ineffective. And then I had the opportunity to travel to Ottawa. And the Ottawa board had this, a startup company that created an app for them that brought all of the curriculum expectations into their data collection tool. And then my wheels started turning and I thought, what a great concept if we could have that connection. And here in the board, we have clustered our expectations into essential learnings. And so when I met with Angie Mercier and Scott Lomax, we had an opportunity to pilot a product that would start doing this for us. And it really, we were excited about looking and working with this company because they would take our feedback and make changes that we were suggesting. And so we are not selling this product today. We are right in the crux of things. We haven't gone through a reporting cycle. But I did want to say that we're excited that we have had this opportunity and that we hear your needs. And as we find out information, we will pass that along.
Okay, so what is this actually looking like at Bluebell? So back in the spring, Emily approached a bunch of teachers on our staff, tried to get a variety in terms of subjects that teachers taught. And we met a couple of times in the spring and we were introduced to this product, which we're calling Trillium Advanced Assessment. So we had an opportunity to get logged in, sort of see how it kind of came out of the box, right? What did it look like? And we started giving our feedback. And we actually made some changes right off the bat in the springtime so that when you input an assessment, you're selecting which essential learning you're assessing for that input. So that was one of the first major things that we changed about it.
It was really our objective that we weren't going to end up with another tool that wasn't going to work. We weren't going to settle for another broken tool. So the advocation on the teacher part and on the administration part with the company has been really important.
I'll just go back here. So it's an online platform, so you can access it on your Chromebook, on your iPad, that provides teachers with several different options to record and report on assessments. Okay, so that's just a screenshot. Here's our group here, meeting in the spring. Meeting in the spring here. So it was 27 teachers, and then Emily just updated us that we're up to 39. So the buzz is spreading amongst the teachers.
We're at a little over half of our staff now are part of this project.
And what we've instructed them to do is use Trillium AA, but also use whatever else they were using. So whether that was MarkBook or something else that they relied on. So we're not asking them to jump in with both feet, but use it alongside something else. So it's this team of teachers and admin that meet about once a month. And when we meet, it's really, really informal. And what we want to emphasize to everybody is that we're not experts. We got introduced to the product at the exact same time as everybody else. We're learning alongside of them. So it's really, really collaborative. We come and the direction of the meeting is based on the needs of the staff who are part of the team. As I said before, it really, truly is out of the box, and the company is working really well with us when we want to see changes to see how that can look for us, right? So it's a lot of us generating feedback, speaking with them, and hopefully get a tool that matches our needs. So you're wanting to know what it looks like. So we're not actually going to go into it today, but I did take a screenshot of one of my classes. So normally the students' names would be alongside here. So I know it's really, really hard to see, but I'll just try to walk you through the setup of this. So each sort of beige chunk right here is an assessment that I've put in. When you put it in, you have the option to say whether it's going to be formative or summative. So the ones that are in blue right up here are assessment of learning, so it's actually counting for the overall grade, versus the gray here are formative. And so that's for you to see how they're doing, but it's not actually going into the final grade. When you go to input something, you have the option to say which essential learning is being assessed for that particular piece. So for instance, my law class just did this charter challenge project, and so it tracked, and I can't even tell right now because it's blurry, but let's say essential learning 1, 2, and 3. And then I also, as I have here, wanted to assess the learning skills alongside of that. So it was a group project, so I assessed collaboration, and I also assessed responsibility. So we like that we can tie a learning skill directly to a particular piece. You also have the opportunity to make notes. So we talked about the need to have observations, conversations with the students. So if you want to mention something about a particular student with an assignment or something to do with a test or just a general observation from the day, you can put that in. There's also a column for completion, late, had to redo, that type of thing, where you can put that into a column. Color coding. Is one of the more positive things that the staff members are commenting about, and that was certainly something that I was trying to achieve before this came out. I wanted to be able to see from an entire class profile perspective how everybody was doing, but then to be able to key in on a specific student and see, you know, if I see blue across the board, I must be an awesome teacher. But, you know, or, you know, keying in on where we need to revisit. And I guess we'll get to that in a second, but you're going to be able to tell for a particular student how have they done on all the opportunities you've given them to show Essential Learning 1, Essential Learning 2, Essential Learning 3, and where do you maybe have to go back and revisit from an entire class perspective or for an individual student.
And the Essential Learnings is an element that was customizable for us at Bluevale. When it came to us originally, it was curriculum strands. And we are working with Essential Learnings at Bluevale, and so we asked them, can we edit that and make that change? And they made that happen for us. So it's in keeping with the ideas and the values that we're trying to implement at our school.
Okay. Just before I get into this part, one of the other positives of this is just the buzz that it's created amongst the staff. So we've already talked about the group started in the 20s in the spring, and now we're up almost to 40. And the best part is that it's just gotten people talking about assessment. So I think as teachers, and Bluebell's probably pretty typical of other schools, you're in your own classroom or you're within your own department and you're not talking as an entire group about assessments. We just really like the buzz that it's created. With anything, obviously it's not perfect, so we're working through different challenges. One particular thing that we wanted to highlight today that has to do with triangulation is that we would like to see a report that sort of captures a student, right? That we really can key in and see that triangle and see what the products are, what are the observations, what are the conversations, and we're not feeling that that is currently being offered. So we're in the process of putting together, in our ideal world, this is what it would look like, what can you do for us? So just to kind of explain this, I mean, these are a couple of reports that currently exist. This is Essential Learning 1, Essential Learning 2, 3, 4. So we can see in the opportunities that we've given them to demonstrate that, how are they doing? So you can imagine if you had red here, that now that's something that you have to go back and revisit with that student. Here's where you have the opportunity to input your professional judgment. So again, it spits out a number, but then how would you like to adjust that?
And just to jump in on the sort of student dashboard or student profile part of it is, we really figured that out when it came time for interim progress reports, right? We all had all this information, data put in, it was all color-coded and nice, but I know, I speaking for myself, I was just looking for a button that said, okay, how's Johnny doing? Boom, and then all, where's his attendance? Where's the formative stuff? Where's recent versus consistent? Can I flip through it?
Can I
is he doing okay? Is he not doing okay, right? It has one of the things it is good for is it has attendance built into it, so the attendance we're already using is connected to this, and it's a little bit more comprehensive in this than what you get in the regular attendance. It also, you can see student background, like sort of their education history and how they've done and how they're working towards their diploma. So those are a couple positives too, but we really would like to see some kind of dashboard that we can manipulate a little bit to get multiple views on how a student's doing.
Yeah, Ben drew one last week and sent it to
them. Yeah, I
took
a picture of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we haven't got feedback on it yet, but they have been great for feedback so far.
So at the end of it all, what's our goal? So our goal, once the project is completed at the end of next semester, is to determine how successful the tool was in regards to its ability to allow teachers to record and track data gathered through triangulation. We're not willing to just, like I said, accept another broken tool. We need to look at the tool critically and determine whether it fit the needs that we had, okay? So we've determined some success criteria that ultimately at the end of our pilot project will have the various teachers weigh in on whether they feel the tool met that particular success criteria. And this is what we've determined thus far. We'd be interested if you folks have some ideas in regards to success criteria for an assessment tool. So if you want to jump in at any point, feel free. One of the things we've talked about again is, does it allow us to track, measure, and report on triangulation? If it can't do that, then it's not something that's going to work for us, okay? Is the tool able to generate a clear profile of student learning, which includes assessment for, as, and of learning? As well, does it give us the option to look at most recent, most consistent patterns? Lastly, is the tool easy to use? I take for granted that a teacher's going to be willing to like walk into that new tool and problem solve their way through. That's how I approach things. That's what I like to do, right? Tech is my passion. But not every teacher is going to be like that. It needs to be accessible for everybody. And not just in reference to its user friendliness, but also various departments in our schools have different needs. And that's one of the things that we've learned through these conversations that we've been having at our meetings is, French and music particularly have different things they need this tool to do. So in order for the tool to really be functional, everybody in the building has to be able to use it and feel like it's working for them.
Any questions?
Any questions? Yes.
Great presentation, guys. Is it app-based at all, like looking at making those observation conversations in the classroom, can you use a cell phone to do it, or is it really
you
more
can.
It's mobile responsive, right?
So you're
it's
going
no
to the website,
yeah,
so but not, this was not built for the phone.
Yeah, so they have a mobile version
sure.
of the
okay,
site.
Okay, so it's switch over.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The problem they said with making it an app was the framing of it on a smartphone
yeah.
screen. They couldn't figure out how to get everything.
So everything, like if you know, you can sometimes see websites built for mobile responsiveness because you'll see a lot of empty space on one side, right? So a lot of white space over here and a lot of columns or data or whatever's on one side. So that means when they shrink the screen, it'll be able to fit this stuff. That might present a problem, we're not sure yet, when it comes to something like a student profile, because we want to see all kinds of information right up there.
Mm-hmm.
So we're still working on that part, but yeah, that's what they've gone with is the mobile responsiveness. Yeah.
Are you using a professional judgment, that category, as part of summative or formative assessment?
That would be some, if for professional judgment, I think the thing that Lindsay was showing you here was probably something towards a midterm mark or towards a final mark, so at the very end.
So probably some of the courses, let's say if you have a, you're doing a bunch of exercises for a month and they're deemed as, say, formative, but if you could use your professional judgment on those, that could be triangulated into the overall mark.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, yeah, and we're looking again, for something where we could see all that on one screen,
right.
So then you could balance it out maybe, or take it into consideration a little bit easier. Yeah, sure.
Are you entering in levels or?
It gives you the option to do either. Yeah.
You can do both, right? So I stick both. Oh, I stick mostly with levels myself,
okay.
But when we get into tests, sometimes that gets a little bit trickier, right? So. Some people are using a mixture of both, I think.
There's a test where I chose to do out of, and so it's stated as like the little numbers are a percentage, but everything else I input as levels. So you have that option on that input screen.
And it still color codes it the same way. So the levels are matched up with ranges of grades.
Can you still modify weighting for assignments? Or can you?
Yes.
Can you modify weighting to get an overall idea between like formative, conversation, summative? Like, could you say 90%, you know, summative, 10% formative? Is there any way to adjust it?
Not yet. Not that. Well, at least I don't think so, guys. If you want to chime in, that's sort of what we're looking at.
Talking about limitations right now.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the things that we're trying to balance out. And I don't know necessarily if you want to put weightings to formative versus summative, because I think that just ties you in again, right? And that limits your professional judgment again.
But this is one of the reasons why we wanted to bring the presentation, because we wanted to hear what other people thought, things that we haven't necessarily thought of ourselves. So that's a question that is worth puzzling over for sure.
Yeah.
How easy is it to work on a normal size screen?
Like a desktop screen?
Easy.
It's the easiest.
Seems like there's a
desktop.
Lot I'm going to be nice to have on a big screen, but.
I agree. Like, so this is early on in a course, right? We're not even at midterm.
No,
yeah.
Like there seems like a lot of data.
Right, like you can imagine it goes.
You want to look at a student's perspective. You want to be able to see.
Exactly. And it's okay. So this is sort of a class view with assignments across here. And I think that's okay to see overall trends. Maybe a whole class isn't getting an essential learning. But again, that's why we're trying to ask them for a student profile to put it all on one screen and sort of condense all that information so we don't have to scroll through.
Do you find you're able to make assessments during class with this, or is it something you sit down after and pick away?
It's so I found that to be another challenging aspect, right? So my students right now are working on their essay for Hamlet. So I'm going around and I'm talking to them about, you know, their progress, they're showing me their work, and I'm still kind of making jot notes and then going over and like typing the jot notes at the end of the period into the program. And that's something, Ben, you were talking about even before the presentation started, that you feel kind of like you get sucked into that computer screen and then you're missing the observations and the conversations.
Yeah,
so
missing what's going on in class. And some people are really good. They can walk around with a tablet or a phone and beep, 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 or type something and no problem, right? I'm just not one of those people.
No.
So I'll still go around with a notepad and go take all my observations, and then at the end of the period or at lunch, I'll try. Yeah. But I think that's the same with just about any technology we try to use, right? It's that balance between sitting in front of a screen and actually being present.
Thank you.
Just kind of go back to the weightings thing. Can you make, like, one thing I would love personally from a professional judging standpoint at the end of a semester is making changes to weightings based on individual students. So I'll give you like an example. So say, as a teacher, if I'm looking at the writing strand for English, if I look at the form of writing, say at 3 marks, like there was 60 at the start of the term, 70 in the middle, and 80 at the end, I mean, I really, the students demonstrate they're learning, they're an 80-level student. I should be penalizing the weightings of saying like a 3 equal weightings throughout the semester, like about 60 to 70. But again, difference there too, like a student might have been 8 in the middle and had a really rough time at the end of the year, and so they tanked on the final writing, but I'm looking at what they demonstrated for their skills to me. Can I make tweaks for individual students at the end of the semester to play around with that final mark?
Not yet, but I don't think
that's one of the biggest limitations of our individual
yeah.
Well,
that's
you
really
can
bad.
Do that edit, right, at the end, where it allows you to edit the final mark.
But not yet. I think
no,
it's
like
what I'm
doing
now.
Now that you've
changed
the final
mark.
Oh, editing the weightings on the balance.
Yeah.
So kind of like.
We'll write that down.
Yeah,
listen,
well,
that's
ask.
What I would love to see.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, and that'll tie in with that one, too.
Ask for what you want yourself.
I think we're out of time. Yeah, I've got several people doing this.
Thank you guys.